Hello, welcome to the episode number 7 of Implementing Exceptions with Ruby. My name is Hernan Wilkinson. I work at 10 Pines and remember that we are implementing a new model of exceptions using the Ruby language. On the last episode, we implemented all the necessary stuff to make test number 4 run that is testing that we can have nested exception handlers. What we're going to do in this episode is to start making our code a little bit nicer. The first to-do, we are not going to try to solve it now, neither the number 4. We're going to start with to-do number 5, that is that we have to always uninstall an exception handler when we send the message install handler 4. Right now, the exception handler object, that is the class, is not sure that every time that you send the message install new handler 4, the exception handler is uninstalled, sending the message uninstalled to it. So exception handler is kind of trusting the sender of this method, of this message, and that's not a good idea from the design point of view. It is better for the exception handler to be sure that every time he installs a handler, that one is uninstalled. So what we're going to do is we're going to give all that responsibility to the exception handler object, and we're going to do that renaming. First of all, the first thing we're going to do is rename this message from install new handler 4 to install new handler while evaluating, and we're gonna pass self as a parameter, and we're going to move all this code here. So now install new handler while evaluating is going to receive a closure or a block, let's call it a block, and what we want to do is to create the new handler. And after that, we're going to send the message call to a block and then uninstall. Let's run the test. Everything is working fine. That change is okay. We don't need to put the exception handler here. We can send the message uninstall to self. And now there is another problem. And that problem is that uninstall is a message that anyone can send. So we are not safe yet. So one possible solution is to make the uninstall an inline, so to remove the uninstall method, and you know, everything is working fine, but now the code is more difficult to read than the previous solution, because on the previous solution it was very clear that in the ensure we were uninstalling the handler, and now here we cannot see that so easily. We have to understand what we're doing, you know, setting the last handler with the previous one. So I think it's better to have that message, but we're going to use the possibility that Ruby gives us about having private methods, and we're going to make that method private. Everything is working fine, so now we can easily understand what is doing here on the ensure. So cool, we have done our first to-do, and now we are sure that every time that the message that a new handler is installed, it is also uninstalled, because we only provide this method to do it. Okay, the next one is do not use nil at the end of the list of handlers. And that's something that, you know, nil is an object that we should not use at all. Nil is an schizophrenic object. It's an object that has a lot of meanings. Sometimes it means that a variable has not been initialized. Sometimes it means that there is no handler for an exception. Sometimes it means that the file is not open, etc., etc. So it's not a good idea to, you know, to abuse of the nil object And remember that nil is an object that is not polymorphic with any other object, and that forces us to have an if every time that we want to reference that object. So to remove this nil, we're going to use a pattern, and the pattern is the null object pattern. The null object pattern says that you have to specialize nil for a particular case. In this case, the what we want to represent is the absence of a handler. So what we're going to have is an object that is going to represent an undefined exception handler. And we're going to make the undefined exception handler to be polymorphic with the exception handler with the message handle, in such a way that the undefined exception handler is going to do exactly what we have here. And we're going to remove this. So when an undefined exception handler receives the message handle, it will tell the exception handler not found, sending that message. And now what we need to do is we need to initialize last handler with an undefined exception handler by default. So that's what we're going to do here. Let's define initialize last handler, and that is going to set last handler to undefined exception handler new. Okay, and let's call that, let's send that message from here. So now let's see if all the tests run, and they run. And that's because when it gets to the last exception handler, the last exception handler in the list is an undefined exception handler that will send the message handler not found to the exception. Okay, so now we could leave our implementation like this. You know, Ruby is a dynamic language, so dynamically typed language. So we don't need to provide a common supertype for these two classes, but it is a good idea to do it, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to create a superclass for these two classes, undefined exception handler and exception handler, that will define the common protocol for objects instances of those classes. So now we have to define to decide the name of that superclass. A common name that people usually use is, for example, abstract exception handler, and or I don't know, something like that, base exception handler or something like that. But that is a really bad name for a class. The abstract word should never be used as a name of a class. So what we're going to do is we're going to rename exception handler, and we're going to provide it a better name to it, because now an exception handler can be undefined or defined. So in that way we will have, you know, the partitions of exception handlers as defined and undefined, and that is going to be easier to recognize when you see the name. So we're going to rename exception handler to define exception handler. Let's see if everything works fine. And yes, it does. And now let's call this class exception handler, and let's define handle an exception in such a way that it says should implement by subclass, and let's send the message fail if this method is evaluated. Now let's make undefined exception handler to subclass exception handler, and also let's do that with define exception handler. Cool, let's run the test, and everything keeps working. So we are not using nil anymore. and that is great. I'm very happy with that. I don't like need at all. So now let's do point number 7, make handle nicer. Let's see what's wrong with handle. Well, now it looks a little bit nicer than before, because we don't have that nested if inside it, this else, but there are still some things that we can make a little bit nicer, like for example, what's the meaning of this? You know, it's not very declarative. If you look at this code, you have to understand what you really want to mean with it. So it's better to comment that with a message. So let's do an struct method. Struct method. And let's call it shootHandle. And now it looks nicer. If you handle an exception, then handle it. If not, send the message handle to the previous one. Okay, cool. Now it looks nicer. So let's move this to done. What else can we do? I think it's okay. Let's review a little bit what we have. The class proc is very compact and very simple, easy to understand. We have exception handler as the root of our exception handler's hierarchy. That can be undefined exception handler or defined exception handler that has a last handler, and also this method install new handler, blah blah blah, the handle should handle. So it's okay, there is nothing to change here, but that we're still having this last handler as a class instance variable. Let's put that in the to-do. Same with last handler. Cool. What else? We have new exception that is not doing anything special. Okay, and handle exception. We have that to do about the handle not found strategy and how to test it. So nothing to improve here. And now we have the test. And yes, something that we can change about the test is their names. We're still keeping those names that we didn't want to spend too much time. But now we wrote four tests and we have a very interesting model, we can start renaming this test. So let's rename test number 1 to what really is doing. And what this test is doing is it is verifying that if no exception is throw, then the handler is not evaluated. So let's rename the test like that. When no exception is thrown, its handler is not evaluated. Cool. So remember, the name of the test are always long and they have to be functional names. They have to be really clear about what you are testing and what's the functionality that you are testing. For example, a really bad name for this test could be test call handling. That's a really bad name for the test, because you are not, for the name of the test, you cannot know exactly what you're testing. You know that you're testing the message call handling, but you don't know in which case, what's the situation, what's the context that you're using to test that message. So it is better to have long names and to be very clear about the functionality that the test is testing. Okay, the second test, we're gonna call it when an exception is thrown, its handler is evaluated. This is the opposite evaluated. It is the opposite of the previous test. The third test is testing that this handler not found strategy is evaluated when an exception is not handled. So let's do that. When an exception is not handle, then handler not found strategy is evaluated. Well, the name is not really that bad, but something I don't like about this name is that it says that handler not found strategy is evaluated. That is the same as the name of this message. But I don't have a good name for it right now, so let's leave it like that. It is better than test 3. And test number 4 is testing that we can have nested handlers, so let's rename the test to be that. So nested nested handlers are supported. I don't know if this is not really a good name neither, but it's better than test 4. Okay, let's see if all tests run. They run, and I think we're done. We're done for this episode with what we had. So let's move this to done. And I think we will have to start addressing this to do on the next episode. So let's review what we've done. Okay, so from the design point of view, we use the idiom XXX while. That is something that Kenbeck documented in his famous book Smalltalk Best Practices. It's a very, very good book about writing good code. It's written for Smalltalk, but I recommend you to read it. If you know Ruby, it's not going to be that difficult. And he proposed to use that message XXX while, like for example install while evaluating, that you know, it in this case it installed the handler but also uninstalled it after running it. So it's a very good idiom to use, for example, with resources like files, memory, sockets, or whatever. We also use the null object pattern to represent the absence of an exception handler, and we got rid of the nil at the end of the exception handler list. We created a polymorphic hierarchy of exception handlers. Remember that's something that the dynamic type languages don't force you to do, but it's a good idea to have hierarchies of classes that you can see and recognize very easily. And to define in the superclass or the interface of that hierarchy the main protocol of those objects. We also modify some methods to be more intention revealing, like the handle method. We use better name for objects, we name the test correctly, and in the end we improve our design. That's very, very important. From the TDD point of view, remember that if you are growing your design, if you are making your code step by step, and if you are using an iterative way of programming, it is fundamental to improve the design of the solution to avoid getting a legacy system. A legacy system is not a system where the code is when you cannot find the code, or where the architects left the project. A legacy system for me is a system that you don't want to change anymore. That every time that you see it and you see and you have to modify a method, you don't want to do it because it is so difficult. It takes so much time and energy to do it that you feel that you are not in the mood of changing it. So a legacy system is a system that you don't want to change. And that's something that you get there if you don't improve your design all the time. So TDD helps us to have the courage to change what it is already working and avoid getting a legacy system. And that's very important. That's one of the main benefits of TDD. So well, I hope you liked this episode. It was all about making our design look nicer, and I hope to see you in the next one.